discarded old business models. As National CEO of National Art Strategy, Russell Willis Taylor, has waggishly observed, the Reformation was a great time to be a land buyer and a rotten time to be a monastery. And on some level, we should be asking ourselves whether the orchestral model is the monastery of the present. And frankly, at its most profound, the Reformation at its very heart questioned the necessity of intermediation in the divine-spiritual relationship. Why do I need a priest to intercede with God? A question that is directly paralleled by the rising question of the necessity of a professional artist for a creative experience. Indeed, in a debate I witnessed in Montreal 4 years ago between a critic and a government minister, the minister, who was opposed to arts funding from the government, said, "Look, you people," which is never my favorite phrase, he said, "you people wanted everybody to be arts aware, declare victory and move on. Everybody in my district paints pictures, they compose music, they act in school plays, they sing in choirs, they write poetry in their own home. You professional people could disappear tomorrow and no one would even notice the difference." A stunning rebuke of the entire nonprofit art sector that no one in that audience was able to counter. I say to you, we are in the arts reformation. And just as the religious reformation reconceived and broadened the idea of where religion would operate, how religion would operate, who would be empowered to act, giving new rise not only to clergy to play new roles, but new opportunities for the layperson to assume responsibility for his or her own spiritual experience, we are seeing right now an explosion of new practices and challenges to old assumptions. We're seeing the blurring of the previously rigid divide between amateur and professional, the emergence of a group called the Pro-Ams, avocational artists doing work at a professional level. You see their work on YouTube, in dance concerts, in videos, on street corners, and more. And the rise of hybrid artists at the other end. Professional artists who work not out of economic necessity, but because they believe the work they are called to do cannot be accomplished in a concert hall, an auditorium, or a theater. These hybrid artists are working in new ways, artists like Liz Lerman and Cornerstone Theater and Mark Bamudi Joseph. We're seeing the witnessing and the birth of a new generation of pioneer artists and managers who are blazing trails where none have existed before. These artists and these organizations are expanding and exploding the world of aesthetic possibility, even while they are upending and discarding the assumption that true cultural authority resides with old organizations. Now, if you think I'm going to say that the orchestras and the cultural authorities of the past are not needed, let me be perfectly clear. The religious reformation did not end the Catholic Church, which continues to be deeply meaningful to millions worldwide, even while it reduced the Catholic Church's stranglehold on what religion would mean. Similarly, I think the best of our institutions will continue to be worthy of our investments as they too offer deep spiritual experiences to an audience hungry for those. And whatever we do, we have to continue to nurture those orchestras and opera companies and large institutions as we move forward, recognizing they're our best chance of lives of economic dignity for artists, and they're the logical place where artists who need to work at a certain scale will find a home. But those big organizations are less likely to dominate the large arts landscape and the philanthropic support systems as they have in the past. And so I think we've all got to ask ourselves hard questions. How do we think about interacting with the growing tsunami of creative energy that typically exists outside our classrooms, our performing arts building, our orchestra halls, and our performing arts centers? How do we expand our vision to see the role of the arts in social orchestration? Social orchestration in which a performance is a piece, but only a piece of what we're called to do. What if the role of artists is no longer to present experiences to be consumed, but to watch experiences that will be springboards to their own creativity? Can we think of our organizations as not as self-contained, but as platforms designed to aggregate creative energy? Can we increasingly, in short, see arts organizations as firmly rooted in the world rather than separated from the world, that speaks with the world in dialogue rather than at the world or to the world, that mirrors in its business practice the same flexibility and openness and curiosity that all too often the aesthetics seek to impart. Recognizing this moment is one of fundamental change. The Doris Duke Charitable Foundation, in response to these conversations, explicitly endorsed innovation as part of our art strategy. Now, innovation for a lot of people means a lot of things. It means big, it means flashy, it means untested, sometimes it means undisciplined or haphazard, but for us, innovation is a precise word. Courtesy of Richard Evans, the CEO of EMC Arts, who says the following three-part definition. Number one, innovation is a new pathway to mission fulfillment, a reminder that real innovation is deeply connected to core purpose, not tangential. That it is discontinuous from previous practice, or in his driving metaphor, it's a hard left rather than a gradual right. And for me, most compellingly, it springs from changes in underlying organizational assumptions. A marketing department or an artist who says, boy, I'm going to get on the internet because I want to just send out those email blasts and send out my brochures to everybody through electronic means, is not really an innovator. They're really an adapter, adapting old patterns to new technologies. A marketing department or an individual artist who moves into the web territory, aware that while the focus of the traditional marketing has been sending out word, the web is about what comes back being more important than what you send out, shifts the underlying assumption of marketing from broadcast to conversation, and then that change opens the door for innovation. In our work, we've learned an incredible amount already about the three key building blocks: leadership, executional capacity, including change management, and the importance of capital or money dedicated to that purpose. We've seen the importance of commitment from the top. If the CEO isn't committed, don't even bother. We've seen the value of assembling diverse groups of people, diverse in age, in generation, in race, in point of view, in affiliation with your organization, but all focused on a common problem. We've seen the value of multiple incremental steps as a part of, tested at a survivable scale. We've seen those necessarily against a backdrop of ongoing practice, and we've seen the usefulness and necessity of change capital, resources either awarded from the outside or designated internally, precisely to support these efforts. If you're thinking about innovation, there are two different kinds of innovation you might find useful. Jerry and Monique Sternin, in their book, Positive Deviance, How Unlikely Innovators Solve the World's Roughest Problems, shared their attempts to solve child malnutrition in Vietnam. After decades of working with scientists and doctors and more to no particular results, the Vietnamese government hired the Sternins and said, we're giving you 6 months to solve child malnutrition. Good luck. The Sternins began by holding meetings, not unlike this one, where anybody from the community who was interested could attend. In those meetings, they said, please self-identify how many of you are well off, how many of you are whatever the equivalent would be to middle class, how many of you are poor, how many are very poor, is there anyone here who's very, very poor? And then they say, who knows a child who is very, very poor who is not malnutrition? A few hands up, they said, those are the kids we've got to pay attention to. In studying those children, they found that there were several things they had in common. The mothers of those children did several things. Number one, they fed their children smaller portions, but more frequently during the day. Number two, when they went to ladle the soup that was the traditional meal in the villages, they would make sure to dig deep to drop some of the nutrients that would have settled to the bottom of the pot, which was at variance with practice where often the young people skimmed the top while the depths were reserved for the elders. And perhaps most interestingly, every day as they left the rice paddies where they worked, they'd bend over and pick up a small handful of crab or shellfish or whatever lived in the paddies, and they'd throw it out into the soup. And with those three changes, emulating those three practices, child malnutrition in those villages was reversed. Now, these villagers, which the Sternins would call positive deviants, or which, if you know Chip and Dan Heath in their book Switch, How to Change When Change is Hard, would call bright spots, different term for the same phenomenon, offer us four important lessons. Number one, innovators are observable exceptions. They are identified by others who see them behaving outside the norm and having practice. It's not that they feel differently or think differently, they behave differently. Number two, innovators are often unaware they behave differently than anyone else. For frankly, when they went to the mothers said, really? You know, not everybody's reaching down for those school crabs or shovel. Really? We didn't know. You know, so it's not that innovators are necessarily withholding information. They often don't think the information they have is necessary to share. Number three, and here these last two are my favorite. Number three, innovators work with the same resources and face the same conditions as non-innovators. Their success is not the result of more resources or more money or because they got a big grant from a foundation. They are working with the exact same resources as those who are not succeeding and succeeding against the same odds their colleagues face. And number four, innovators prove that solutions to problems typically already exist within the community itself. Innovation on one level simply involves shepherding and gathering the innovation that is already a field in practice itself. You can tell my plane got in at 2 a.m., I apologize. And by replicating that behavior. My favorite example right now of innovation, frankly, comes from the orchestra field. And I don't know how many of you are orchestra musicians, but I've always said in looking at a business model, I would open a vein before I would run an orchestra. With all my love of the symphonic music, it seems to me to be the hardest business model in the arts to reform. What do we call it, the fishbowl? Or as I'm thinking of it, it's the bear baiting next door where you tie the bear and you say the dogs are set up. We can talk about why that isn't there, but the St. Paul Chamber Orchestra to me is attempting as radical a reinvention of a business model as any arts organization in the country. If you know the SPCO, they began this journey by redefining their mission, abandoning the traditional mission of to be a world-class orchestra playing the symphonic repertoire, which is the sort of mission of many orchestras around the country, in favor of a new mission, a two-word mission, patron development. A mission that has economic consequences, to be sure, but one that by what they really mean is our role is to take people who are nominally, if at all, connected to the symphonic music and make them addicts for that repertoire. A mission that leaves you no choice but to change if your audience numbers are plummeting. If your mission is to be a world-class orchestra playing the great repertoire, you can play to an empty hall and be mission congruent. If your mission is patron development and your numbers are down, you have no choice but to change. They have discarded the maestro model and no longer have a maestro at all, but instead work with six artists with staggered overlapping contracts. Artists of world-class stature, Don Upshaw is one, who worked directly with the musicians and the administrators to chart the artistic destiny for the company. They've decided that the concert hall is not the venue. It's a venue, it's not the venue, and they perform in ballparks, in churches, in school auditoriums, gymnasiums, and more. They have redirected the attention of their board to stop being guardians of past rituals and to be change agents for the future. And they have recalibrated their ticket structure, with 90% of tickets being $10 or $20, and the remaining 10% being $40. I don't need to tell you guys, in the orchestra field, where typically tickets are $80, $90, $100 or more, how seismic that is. A strategy that they've embarked on by equally rigorous decisions of whether they're going to stop doing. Not only discarding the maestro model, but they ended all print advertising. No newspapers, no flyers, no postcards, etc., a move that is saving them in excess of $1 million a year. Already, they have seen the paid percentage of their house skyrocket from the low 60s to the mid 90% when they play in the concert hall. And many questions are on the table already. At lower prices, will people come more often? We think they will. Will people be more adventurous in what they come to see? We think they will. Will they be less pissed off when they see something they don't like? We think they will.